moment. We're here to worship this faithful God, this good God that is our Lord and Savior and so kind to us. He is here with us this morning. Is worthy of our praise and adoration. Amen. Just want to welcome you here this morning. I want to say to all of our fathers, Happy Father's Day.
Psalms 96, 1 through 96. Let's sing unto the Lord a new song. Sing unto the Lord, all the earth. Sing unto the Lord, bless his name. Show forth his salvation from day to day. Declare his glory among the heathen, his wonders among all the people. For the Lord is great, greatly to be praised. He's to be feared above all gods, for all the gods of the nations are idols, but the Lord be the heavens. Honor and majesty are before him. Strength and beauty are in his sanctuary. Give unto the Lord, O ye kindreds of the people. Give unto the Lord glory and strength. Give unto the Lord the glory due unto his name. Bring an offering and come into his courts. O worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. Fear before him, all the earth. And Lord, we come before your presence, God. We pray you would meet among us, God. I pray, God, help us, God, to set ourselves aside, Lord, to worship you, not to worry about what other people think, God. Let us pour our praises to you, God. Lord, assign to you glory and strength that's already yours, God. I pray whatever is between us and you, God, I pray you lay it aside. We'd ask, Lord, that you forgive us, God, and repent. May be right with you, God. We pray, God, you inhabit our praises this morning. In Jesus' name.
Thank you. Oh, okay.
holy God this morning in this house. The stillness in your heart, your holy reverence before Almighty God. Bow your heart before Him, bow your face before Him. Lift up your hands to the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Isaiah was a good man when he saw the Lord. When he saw Jesus on his throne, he said, "I'm undone, I'm unclean. I dwell in the midst of a people of unclean lips." Before he could go any further, the Lord sent one of the angels to take a coal from the altar, touched his lips, purged him, and said, "This has made you clean." We've been purged and washed in the blood of the Lamb of God, Jesus Christ, who died on the cross for our sins. What a holy God, what a holy, almighty God we serve. There's none like Him, there's no compare. No one that compares to the Lord. Father, we just pray this morning, God, that You would have that place in our hearts, God, of true reverence, and God, that we would give You the glory and the honor that's due Your holy name, God. We wouldn't take lightly the Lord and the things of God. We bless You this morning. Let's sing that one more time. You are holy. Thank you.
Thou art my sister, and call understanding my kinswoman.
This is from the Word of God. This is from Proverbs that he wrote. And there's instruction when he says, "My son, keep my words." And I'm preaching to the fathers this morning. Glad that you're here today. We have some that are out of town, but very thankful that you're here. I'm very thankful for the fathers that we have in this church. You know, fathers can get a bad rap. Maybe some deserved, not all. But fathers, you know, we hear so much about deadbeat dads, and we hear about dads that are AWOL and are not present. And certainly that is rampant in our country and in our culture today. But I'm very thankful for the fathers that we have. I'm thankful for fathers that exemplify Christ to their children in this church. I'm very thankful. There's not one in here perfect. Only the Lord is perfect, but I'm very thankful. Just real quickly, this is just a bit of trivia. Mother's Day, I forgot when Mother's Day, but Mother's Day has been around forever. You know, Mother's Day gets a whole lot more fanfare for the most part than Father's Day. But there was a young lady, she was named Sonora Dodd. In 1909, she was listening to a Mother's Day sermon, and she said there ought to be something to honor fathers. She was raised by her father. It was just her and her father. And she made a push for this, and it wasn't until 1956, okay? This was in 1909 when she started pushing for this. But in 1956, that Congress passed a joint resolution to recognize Father's Day. But we hear so much about dads that are not living up and not measuring up to the standard. I thought it was funny, somebody mentioned that in the dictionary, in the Webster's dictionary, the word father comes right after the word fathead, and it comes right before the word fatigue, I think. And both may be appropriate for many of us as fathers, but I'm very thankful for the fathers that we have that have come to know Christ and desire to bring up their child or their children in the ways of God. So this, fathers, this is a message for you today. I'm a father as well. It's a message to me, but it's a message to bring up your children in the ways of God. If you're not a father, don't tune me out. Most of you are not fathers, but please, it's God's word. It's for all of us. Pray for our fathers. Amen. But it's a message to train your children in the ways of God according to the word of God. Very simply, I don't have anything that's going to blow your mind that you've just never heard or thought of before. It's an admonition from the Lord to bring up your children in the ways of God. Guide them in wisdom. We just read from Proverbs, "My son, keep my words, my commandments." So he says, keep them and live. And so we're to bring up our children to know the Lord, to walk with him, to serve him all the days of their lives. I want to say this at the very beginning. You can have a father that's godly and does everything appropriately and rightly according to the word of God, and their child still comes out to not serve the Lord as they should. That is possible, okay? And you can have a dad that's lost and is godless, and the child comes out to know the Lord Jesus Christ and walk with him. I think of several examples in the Bible. King Hezekiah is one of my favorite kings. Because King Hezekiah, his dad was godless. His dad let the temple go to just, King of Judah let the temple go down and had the just destroyed and instituted idolatry all over the land. Not Ahab, but Ahaz with a Z. And everything was in disarray when God raises up his son, Hezekiah, who was one of the most godly kings, to restore worship and revival. One of the true wonderful revivals in the history of Israel was under Hezekiah. So you can have a dad that doesn't know the Lord, is not a good father according to the word of God, and the child still comes out to know the Lord. But I'll say this, in either case, either way, either of those scenarios, you as a Christian man and as a father, you have the responsibility to walk in the calling that God's placed in your life. We'll have to leave the results to God. I will believe the promises of God when he says that train up a child the way that he should go, and when he is old, he will not depart from them. It doesn't change
In either case, you can't say, well, I can do everything right, my kids stop, still not know the Lord. Live for God, okay? Trust the promises of God and do what God's called you to do to raise your children in the ways and the things of God, amen? The greatest thing that you can teach your children, the greatest thing, I look around and I see some mechanics and I see, you know, different people that do different things, and you're able to teach your children those things and maybe to change the line on a weed eater, you know, or here's how you hang sheetrock, or here's how you use a cordless drill. All those things, that's part of life, and we ought to teach our children that. But all the things you can teach your children, the greatest by far is to know the Lord Jesus Christ. By far, there's nothing that compares to that. Of all the things you can leave to your children, the greatest is to leave them with a knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ. A true, biblical, saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. To leave them a testimony. You want to leave something for your kids? Leave them a testimony. My dad knew the Lord. My dad walked with the Lord. Leave them that. Leave them that. Ecclesiastes 7 says a good name that has to do with a testimony or reputation. A good name is better than precious ointment. Leave your children that. Leave them a good name. Not that, you know, the courier name is real known far and wide. Leave them the name of Jesus Christ. That you knew the Lord and you taught them and exemplified Christ to them all of their lives and in your home. Greatest thing you can give them is a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. They'll have to choose Christ, but I tell you what, you make it so desirable to them and real to them that they will choose Jesus Christ. They will want to choose Jesus Christ. Everything else is temporal or temporary. Everything else is fleeting. Everything else is secondary to that your child knowing the Lord Jesus Christ and walking with him. Everything else in the end won't last. Everything else in the end will be burned up and it will not benefit them. So the Bible talks about teaching your children, which it does. God teaches us and we teach our children, men and women. But the word teach or taught, I spoke about it on Mother's Day, it means to indoctrinate. That almost sounds like a bad word these days. People are indoctrinated. Well, if you're indoctrinated in the things of God, that's a good thing. Okay, if you're indoctrinated into communism, socialism, something like this, is a bad thing. But the word teach, teaching them your children the word of God, the things of God, means to indoctrinate, to sound down into the ears. You just continually say it. And you do this in love, speak the truth in love. There has to be patience, there has to be compassion, there has to be gentleness. That's all the fruit of the Spirit. That's how we teach by the Holy Spirit. But you sound it down into their words. And I would say, fathers, don't be sidetracked and don't be deceived. Don't let what is your primary occupation become your secondary occupation. If the most important thing you can do is teach your children the things of God, the most important thing you can leave your children is a right relationship with Almighty God through faith in His Son. Don't let that become lost in the shuffle somewhere in the busyness of life. And yeah, it's important, but somehow or another it's down the ladder somewhere now because of the craziness and busyness of life. Don't let you fight for that. You fight to keep that on the top where it should be. And that is your responsibility to bring up your children. That is your greatest duty. Now, I want to talk about a couple of pitfalls. I know from experience, and more importantly, I know from the Word of God, traps that dads can fall into. And a Christian dad is just as likely to fall into these traps as a lost dad, okay? Don't fall into the trap to think or be persuaded that your greatest responsibility as a father, your greatest, is to provide financial things and material things for your children. Don't fall into that trap. Is it your responsibility? Yes. Is it your greatest responsibility? No. If you make it your greatest responsibility, you're going to have problems. You're going to have problems. Don't fall into that trap that your greatest duty in life is to provide a nice material things and money and a nice standard of living. It is your responsibility. it is not your greatest. For what good does a man profit, Jesus said, if he gains the whole world and loses his own soul? It puts it in perspective right there, right? You want to gain the whole world for your children as much as you can get of it, and your child loses their own soul? I promise you, you won't think it's worth it. It's not worth it. Jesus says, for a man's life consists not in the abundance of the things which he possesses. You measure your life, you equate your life and say, my worth is, consistency of it, you know, or is measured by what I have, what I possess. Not at all, other than Christ, the spiritual values, because that's all going to pass away. So I would say don't fall into that trap. You want to provide nice things for your family. You have a responsibility. The Bible says if a man doesn't work, he shouldn't eat. A man says, and we studied, the Bible says in 1 Timothy, we studied it, when it talked about providing for your own, it says if a man doesn't provide for those of his own household, a Christian man, he's worse than an unbeliever, an infidel. That's pretty serious. It's still not your absolute greatest responsibility. Your greatest responsibility is to teach your children and train them up in the ways of God, that they know the Lord, because that's eternal. That's eternal. And God absolutely expects us to provide for our families the necessities of life. He expects that. He's called us to. But a Christian man will quickly realize, I need the Lord to do that. I need the Lord to do that for me. In other words, I need the Lord to provide for me and enable me to provide for my family. And we'll turn to God. We'll turn to the Lord. And we understand that our God shall supply all of our need according to his riches and glory. So a man of God's going to go to the Lord for the provisions for his household. He's going to go to the Lord for that. But don't be sidetracked to thinking that that's your greatest responsibility. I'll say this. You may or may not, dads, you may or may not be able to provide for your children or your family the standard of living, financial standard of living that your neighbor has, or somebody you see on TV. You may not, but that's really not important. That's really not the main thing. Just be faithful. I tell this to men, just be faithful to what God has called you to do and equipped you to do. We have people, and it's wonderful. I think it's a true, wonderful body of Christ and a wonderful representation. We have people of all walks of life in here. And you don't look at anybody as many, any more or less than anybody else. You're not having all that, praise God, that, you know, trying to keep up with the Joneses kind of thing. And I thank the Lord for that. Just be faithful, dads, to work hard, to do what God's called you to and equipped you to do. Work hard and pray hard and trust the Lord to take care of you and your family. In the end, he's the one that's actually providing for your family through you, through your work, through your knowledge, and so forth. The Lord's going to do it, and he's always going to do it. It says in Hebrews 13, let your conversation be without covetousness. So that could sidetrack us, dads, anybody, but we could look around and say, well, I want my children to have what they have. Yeah, financially, maybe you can provide for that, maybe you can't. Just, the Bible says, be content with such things as you have. For he has said, I will never leave thee nor forsake thee. We have that. Amen? You know what I say? Hallelujah. He says, be content with what things you have. He has written, I will never leave you nor forsake you. I'm directing that to fathers today. Teach your children that. Teach your children that Jesus will never leave them nor forsake them. Leave that to them. Doesn't mean that, again, that we don't provide for our families. We do. We just don't want to get sidetracked to making what's of secondary or temporary importance the most important. Okay? Secondly, another trap I believe that men could fall into that we need to avoid as fathers And it's this, and I see a lot of this, okay? I'm pointing my finger, I'm saying I just see a lot of it, even in the Christian world. It is not your primary responsibility to see to it that your children are well-rounded in what the world would call, being well-rounded and balanced. I think I'm very out of balance when it comes to my life with Christ and the world, okay? I want to be out of balance. I don't want to have a blend with the two, okay? And so it's not your primary responsibility to see that your children are what the world would consider to be well-rounded. You know what I believe? If we believe we bring them up in Christ the best that we can, they don't have a relationship with the Lord that's genuine, He'll make them as rounded as they need to be. He'll make them as well-rounded as they should be. Again, I will say this, it does not mean that we withdraw from secular things and go have a commune somewhere out in the woods as Christians. It doesn't mean we withdraw, okay? It does mean that you have a conscience and you're the parent and you ought to, and I ought to be led by the Lord and let Jesus determine how involved my children are in secular things, what they're involved in, and how deeply they are involved in those things. There are some parameters there that are biblical. They're not a matter of opinion, okay? If it's taken us away from the Lord, it's not of God. If it's taken us away from the house of God, it's not of the Lord. And so we have to be led by the Lord in that. Whatever your children partake in, let it be something that you have been prayerful. I'm not saying again that we just withdraw and are recluses. I'm saying that there needs to be some boundaries, and I think those boundaries in Christianity today, at least in America, are crossed over without any thought, without any conviction or conscience about it at all. Was not bathed in prayer, and it certainly wasn't led by the Lord. Keep it holy. Whatever your children do that's not just church life, there's a lot that they do that's not just church life. There should be a lot that they do that's not just here, okay? But whatever it is, keep it holy. Whatever it is, keep it in line with the Word of God and what is befitting of a child of God. What's befitting a child of God? Keep it in line with what actually glorifies the Lord. I would simply say this to dads and to moms. I can't tell you, nor do I desire to tell you, the extracurricular activities, if you want to call it that, that your children are involved in. I will say this. Pray and be honest that you've heard from the Lord. Go as far as the Lord wants you to and no further, okay? And that will always be safe. He will speak to you. He'll lead you and guide you by His Word and by the conscience that He's given you in His Holy Spirit. Now, also, dads, do not let the world dictate to you how you're to raise your children. You know, just because you get older and you're an adult and have kids doesn't mean you don't have peer pressure. You still have peer pressure. Might not be as intense maybe as when you're middle school and high school, but you have peer pressure. Don't let the world dictate to you how you're to raise your children. Or I would say don't let a worldly church, it's worldly and not really walking closely with the Lord, dictate to you or pressure you on how you're to raise your children. Can I say this? I know you know it, but your children don't belong to them. Your children don't belong to the state. Your children don't belong to the government. Your children actually belong to God, and you are the stewards of them. You're the stewards of them. And so this world does not dictate how we're, as God, as men and women of God, are to raise our children. The Lord is the one that guides us and instructs us. Also say this, don't let your children dictate to you how you're to raise them. Don't let your children dictate to you how you're to raise your children. Doesn't mean you don't listen to them and consider them. It means the Lord's leading you and guiding you. You're the mature one in the scenario. You're the mature one in the picture. Okay? Don't let your children determine how you raise them. You know, just thinking about some of these pitfalls and just what some dad might say that was a Christian, and maybe they got caught up in one of these traps, thinking, you know, want their kids to have the nicest, finest things in life and didn't teach them about the Lord, or maybe they turned them over to the world too much. One day saying, well, not much. I was rarely at home because I was always working overtime to provide for my children and so forth. But I did put a good roof over their head. I mean, that's not going to add up. I can promise your children will say, I'd rather have you and live in a tent. I know those extreme examples are saying, my kids don't really know the Lord and walk with God, but they know how to hit a curveball. They don't really know Jesus and walk with the Lord, but they did get a scholarship to go play ball at this college, or academic scholarship. You got to have our priorities straight. God can give them a scholarship to college. He wants them to be good enough to go, they'll go. You understand the point? But don't make that your primary. We get caught up in it because Christians get caught up in it, and Christian peers and other parents, and we find ourselves kind of caught up in the rat race if we don't watch it. Other parents are not, I'm not saying you don't have godly role models to look at, but I'm saying other people are not your standard. The Word of God is your standard. Well, people around are talking. I'm in a Christian school and other parents are talking. They don't really like the way we're raising our kids. I'm raising my kids. They don't agree with the choices that, as a Christian parent, I'm making for my household. The child Christian psychologist doesn't agree with the way I'm raising my child. You know, many other Christian parents don't agree and think that we're being too extreme with our children and how we're raising them. You know what? Go to the Lord. Go to the Lord. If you stand alone, stand alone. If you stand with 1,000 people, stand with 1,000. But hear from God and raise them the way God's Word says to raise them. Instruct them the way God's Word says to instruct them. And you will never go wrong. And so this, nobody is responsible for your children but Almighty God and you. All right? And we keep it that way. You're the dad. You are the adult. It's not an insult. When we say that kids shouldn't be telling you how to raise them, the parents are to dictate from the Word of God. Not an insult that a child's a child and a parent's a parent. It's just a reality. You're the parent. You're to be the mature one. You're to be the godly one. And you are to be led and guided by the Word of God and lead and guide them the same way. And you'll need the Lord to do it. James 1, 5, if any man lacks wisdom, let him ask of God. You need wisdom to raise your children. I know you do, and so do I. Instruct them, explain to them, be loving, be patient, be gentle, be consistent. Very important, be consistent. Don't go to, you know, a spiritual pep rally for a weekend and then forget to read your Bible and go to the church for the next 2 months. Be consistent. Be consistent in your own testimony and how you're raising them, instructing them, reading the Bible with them, and so forth. Be spirit-filled, be spirit-led. You don't have to read some book on how to raise your children by some Christian psychologist. You need to get along with God and be the man you're called to be. And He will help you to do that, I promise you. And lead us by His Word. I can tell you this, something you already know. You will never, never regret bringing up your children and making that first to bring them up to know Christ. You will never look back and regret that. Never. But if you did the opposite, put other things first, and somewhere second or third, fourth or fifth was them knowing God and really walking seriously with the Lord, you're going to live to regret it. You will absolutely live to regret it. You'll never regret putting Christ first. The time you put in raising your children to know Jesus, the effort, the prayer, the time in the Bible that you've dedicated to raise your children in the Lord, the painstaking effort, and at times it is painstaking effort, to stay the course, to take a stand when people around you, even other Christians, are not taking a similar stand, you'll never regret that. You have to answer to God. The hours of prayer on your knees, interceding on their behalf. One day, everything else in this life is going to seem, and it will be, but it'll be more clear to us one day. Everything else in this world and life will be so insignificant. Just so insignificant. You just won't remember it. It just won't matter. And if your children don't know the Lord, and you spend eternity with God in heaven, and your children aren't there with you, can you imagine? Can you think of anything that you would compare to that? Everything else in comparison will seem so unimportant. You won't remember how many kids your son struck out in Little League baseball. You won't remember that. You'll remember my child knows the Lord. He's here with me in heaven. That's what you'll remember. You won't remember what grade they got in some algebra test at that time. I'm not saying we don't try hard on these things and do well. Whatever you do, do all to the glory of God. Okay? We work and we work hard and we try to be successful. And if it's a worthwhile endeavor, it is worthwhile in doing it right and doing it well. Okay? But it all just pales in comparison to knowing Jesus. Keep it that way. Keep it that way now, not just one day when you get to heaven. So I want to talk about just really the second part of this message. And I don't really use always title sermons, but I titled this one, A Tale of Two Sons. You know, there's a famous book, I think Charles Dickens, A Tale of Two Cities. This is a tale of two sons in the Bible. Really, there's three sons, but there's two families. There is Elkanah and his son, his wife Hannah, right? He prayed for a son. She didn't have a son. And she said, Lord, if you'll give me a son, I'll give him back to you all the days of his life. So before he was ever granted to them, before he was ever conceived in the womb, Samuel was already dedicated to God. So we're looking at the tale of two different families. And so the Lord answers that prayer and grants Hannah the son named Samuel, which means asked of the Lord, I've asked him of God. And she received Samuel. And as a child, as soon as he was through being weaned, he was led to the Lord, is the way the Bible puts it, dedicated to God. Before he even knew the Lord personally, he was serving God in the tabernacle. Now Eli was the priest, the adult at that time, who was in the tabernacle and the priest at that time. And he had two sons, Hophni and Phinehas. Okay, and Hophni and Phinehas were just, they were adults. They were, by the time we start reading about them in 1 Samuel. So they were Levites. So Eli's the priest, his sons were priests that ministered, and Levites that ministered in the tabernacle, represented God, or were supposed to, before men. And they were adults at this time. And I just want to read, turn with me your Bibles. I want to talk about just real quickly how we bring up our children and what a difference it makes. Look at 1 Samuel chapter 1. I'm sorry, chapter 2, verse 11. 1 Samuel 2, 11. Now, this is Samuel. And Elkanah went to Ramah to his house, and the child did minister, that Samuel, unto the Lord before Eli the priest. So this was a pattern. By the time we pick up reading about Samuel's parents, we see them going to the tabernacle to worship. It was part of their lives. They were worshipers of the Lord. Verse 18, I'm going to be skipping around quite a bit. But Samuel ministered before the Lord, being a child, girded with a linen ephod. Verse 26, and the child Samuel grew on and was in favor both with the Lord and also with men. So we just see this picture of Samuel dedicated to God. His parents dedicated him to God. He was brought up in the things of God. He becomes one of the greatest men of God that we read about in the Bible, and was used so mightily as a prophet and priest to Israel. And then here are these two contemporaries. Yeah, they're adult, they're older, but the two sons of Eli. Let's read about them just very quickly. 1 Samuel 2:12. Now the sons of Eli were sons of Belial. They knew not the Lord. But you know what they did do? They wore the linen clothes and everything, and they functioned in the office of the priest. And when the people would come to bring their offerings, they would say, oh, that looks like a good steak, a cattle, a sheep, whatever. And they would take it. And people said, no, please, that's an offering to the Lord. Dedicate to God. Whatever's left, you can have. There were laws for what the priest could take. They said, no, we're going to have it right now. They fornicated with women in the courts of the tabernacle. They were sons of Belial. That's what it says. Okay? And far, far from the Lord. Now, what does this have to do with being a father? I want you to read this. So, in chapter 2, verse 22, now Eli was very old and heard all that his sons did. So he heard about all their sin. This is his own sons. He heard all that his sons did unto all Israel, and how they lay with the women that assembled at the door of the tabernacle of the congregation. And he said unto them, why do ye such things? For I hear of your evil dealings by all these people. Nay, my sons, for it is no good report that I hear. Ye make the Lord's people to transgress. If one man sin against another, the judge shall judge him. But if a man sin against the Lord, who shall entreat for him? Notwithstanding, they hearken not unto the voice of their father, because the Lord would slay them. So what do we see here? Eli's the priest. He's also their dad. And they're grown. But he says to them, you know, I've heard of all the horrible, sinful things y'all are doing. It's really not good what you're doing. You shouldn't do that. And they just kind of blew him off. It did what they wanted to do. I feel that he should have seen to it that they didn't do that. Even if he was old and they were younger, he could have got some help if he needed it. You are not going to do this at the door of Almighty God's house. You are not. If I needed to get an army of soldiers or a band of soldiers to see to it, it was almost like he said, I heard what you've done. It sounds, it's not good. I've heard some bad things y'all are doing. And there was almost this permissiveness that he didn't really take a stand. So I want you to skip down and see what the Lord says about this in verse 27. There came a man, so this prophet, we don't know who it is a man of God, unto Eli, and said unto him, thus saith the Lord, did I plainly appear unto the house of thy father when they were in Egypt in Pharaoh's house? And did I choose him out of all the tribes of Israel to be my priest, to offer upon my altar, to burn incense, to wear an ephod before me? And did I give unto the house of thy father all the offerings made by fire of the children of Israel? Wherefore kick ye? Now he's pointing, this prophet is speaking to Eli. He's not speaking to Hophni and Phinehas. He's speaking to the dad. And he says to the dad, wherefore kick ye at my sacrifice and at my offering which I have commanded in my habitation, and honors thy sons above me, to make yourselves fat with the chiefest of all the offerings of Israel, my people. very sobering. Eli didn't commit those sins. Eli was not stealing the sacrifices from the people, as far as I know. He was fat, the Bible says. He didn't make himself fat. Okay? But we don't see that he was taking the offerings and not offering to God the way he, you know, should have. We definitely see he was not doing the sexual immorality that his sons were. But when God speaks to him and deals with them, he says, why do you kick at my sacrifice? It means to despise or to trample down. And I think the key is in verse 29, and honorest thy sons above me. Fathers, don't ever honor your sons or daughters above Almighty God. Well, I love them. They're my heart. My whole heart is my child. I love my children that way too, and we're supposed to. Don't honor your child above Almighty God. That's an idol. Don't you think that your child can't be an idol? They can be. You honor God first. Dads, you put God first, and he will make you the dad you're supposed to be to take care of those children. You honor your sons above me. Oh, sons, I heard y'all doing some terrible things. They didn't stop it. He should have stopped it. That's why he's being dealt with here. He didn't commit those sins, but he led his children, and he didn't deal with them. And it took a stranger, this man of God, this prophet, to come and address the priest about it, about how he brought up his own children. Well, I told my kids to go to church. They don't really want to. See to it. Until they're out of the house and too old and they're on their own. Well, I tell them to read their Bibles. I don't really know if they do all the time. Tell them to pray. See to it that they pray. You know what I'll say, Dad? If you have to go sit in there with them every evening before supper for 15 minutes and with your child read the Bible and pray with them, then do that. But see to it that they do. Don't just say, you should pray. You should have told them, God, that they should do that. If they know, it's on them. No, it's on you. Up to a certain point when they get old enough. See to it that they do. It's kind of like Eli. He told them they were doing wrong. He didn't see to it that they did right. You have that responsibility. I'm going to close with this. By the way, that same prophet said, here's going to be a sign, your two sons are going to die one day. And they did. Not too long after this, there was a battle with the Philistines. And somebody brings word back to Eli, and he says, the Philistines have smitten the Israelites, and the people have fallen dead before them. And the Ark of the Covenant has been stolen, the Philistines have it, and your two sons, Hophni and Phinehas, are dead. He fell over backwards and broke his neck, the Bible says. What a difference in Samuel and those two guys. And I think a lot, I can't say it's all Eli's fault, but there is a responsibility that God held him accountable for. He said, you're kicking it by sacrifice. And I would just say, dads, honor the Lord above all. Don't put your children in some little idol that you just cherish, and they can do no wrong. They can't do wrong. Bible says folly is bound up in the heart of a child. Believe me, it's there. You lovingly correct them, chasten them, instruct them, bring them up in the things of God. Proverbs 29:15 says, the rod and reproof give wisdom, but a child left to himself. That seems to me like Eli's sons. A child left to himself brings his mother shame. Talk about beating your child. We're talking about correcting your child. Rod and reproof in the name of Jesus. You'll never regret it. I'm just closing with this. You go to God. Fathers, go to God. Say, Lord, I feel inadequate. Well, who isn't? We're inadequate even to live this life ourselves to know God, much less bring up our children. He said, no, I'm going to equip you. I've called you, and I'm equipping you. Stay on your face before me. Spend the rest of your life on your face before me, and I will help you parent your children. And I promise you, he you will. I'm going to close with this. John says in 3 John, I'll just read it. The Apostle John, speaking of his spiritual children, I have no greater joy than to hear that my children walk in truth. No greater joy than that. Our little granddaughter, who many of you know, is almost 4 years old, and she stuck a stick in her ear. Children do stupid things. And the ear was bothering her. And she hurt herself pretty bad and was bleeding. And so obviously, naturally, her parents, William, my son, and Addison, our daughter-in-law, they're concerned, and they're bringing her to the doctor, and swollen, the doctor can't see everything, and they're getting reports from the doctor, they bring her to the ENT, and they're a little nervous. Now, they're Christians, my son and his wife are Christians, and they love the Lord, but they're nervous. This is their little child, understandably so. And Alex turns to her parents because she could tell they were nervous and said, Mom and Dad, Jesus has to just speak the word. Not even 4 years old. But we pour that into her when she's here, and the rest of the time she's not here, her mom and dad pour that. If you were at our house when we have our granddaughter, it's a vacation Bible school every day. And then a little fishing with Papa, I'll bring her fishing. But morning, noon, and night, we're talking to her about Jesus. Always. Real life examples. And that's in her. Is she saved yet? I don't think so. I don't think she knows yet, personally. But she's going to be like a little Samuel. And when that time comes, she's going to be right there. Okay? Mom and Dad, all we have to do, Jesus just has to speak the word. Because teaching, I know our parents have stories from the Bible where Jesus just spoke the word and the dead were raised, and spoke the word and the lame were healed, and spoke the word and the blinded eyes were open. That's teaching your child. And I just thank God for it. He gives us the ability to do it. We fall so short, and yet He doesn't fall short. If we'll trust Him, He'll help us to do it. You can stand and be, you can come. I did this for Mother's Day. I would like to do it for Father's as well. Seems like dads don't get quite as much of celebration on Father's Day as moms do on Mother's Day. It's okay. But I want to ask those that are fathers here today to come to these altars and just begin to pray and ask God to strengthen you to be the husband and father to your child or children that He's called you to be. Then I would like to ask, just like we did on Mother's Day, that the family of these dads would come around them and lay their hands and pray for them. Pray for them. And after that, I want to ask if other people, if you feel led, to just go praying with these and pray over somebody. Maybe there's somebody that doesn't have anyone praying with them, that as a believer, you would come and pray over them. Father, we bless you this morning. Thank you that we have a Heavenly Father. We have the best possible Father, the best example of a Father in you, Lord. And we're the sons and daughters of Almighty God. And Lord, you've given us our children, whatever age they are. You've given us our children to be stewards of them, to train them up in the ways of God, that they personally will have a walk with God. They'll be born again. That they will walk closely to Jesus long after we die and are gone, that our children would walk with you, Lord. And I pray for these, our fathers, Lord. We have such wonderful, godly men. We truly do. But I pray you'd strengthen and bless them. They're so blessed, and there's so many pulls and temptations from the world to raise our children the way that others are raising their children. Help us just to hear your voice. Help these dads here today just hear the voice of God and how they raise their children. I pray you give them patience. I pray you give them gentleness. Give us all grace and strength, Lord God, and wisdom, Lord, from on high. I pray you give our children ears to hear and hearts to listen, God, and to obey. Pray for every child here that doesn't know you, whatever age, that as soon as they come to that age and realize they're a sinner in need of salvation, that they would call upon you, Lord, that very day and be born again. Strengthen our parents, God, and strengthen our fathers, Lord, in Jesus' name.